Hello. Erica Lorenz is president of the Yoga Association of Western Mass. And the Yoga Association, by the way, of course, sponsors these talks. They have been for 20 years. She is a training analyst with the C.D. Jung Institute of Boston. And she has sat on the training board, and she was curriculum coordinator. Since 1980, Erica has lectured and taught workshops throughout the U.S. and Canada. She began her career as a dance therapist and has practiced Jungian analysis for almost 40 years. Hard to believe. It's wonderful. It's the erotic feminine soul that's kept her so young. She moved to Western Mass in 2010, which means that we're really very lucky to have such an experienced Jungian analyst right here practicing in Hadley. I was thinking of this word lucky, and particularly in the context of this disturbing political time. And I make a practice of, when I get up in the morning, to list to myself a few things I'm grateful for. This morning when I got up, what came to me was this following list. I'm grateful for Carl Jung, for the depth, breadth, imagination, I could go on, of this great man. I also feel gratitude for the Jung Association of Western Mass, which for 20 years has been presenting these lectures. I feel gratitude for the analysts who practice Jungian psychology. The word soul, erotic, these kind of words, these kind of topics are common parts of the human psyche which we can discuss whatever the moral position of the dominant culture is at the time. Jung has held to these words in our understanding of them, in our exploration of them. And again, to these therapists who do this work, such as Erica or Penny Teresa, hold this spiritual part of the human psyche, the human soul, as they do their work with you, all of us. I felt gratitude to this community, which I consider a Jung at heart community, which is the word from a former board member. And I have so much, and we have so much in common with each other, those of us who are here. And the last of all, I really have gratitude for Erica Lorenz for choosing such a deeply resonant topic to explore with us. Just say the words, you know. How often we get to say these words. Recovering the feminine erotic soul for all of us. I think I'll send that to the upcoming president, etc. I really think that's part of it. Recovering the feminine erotic soul, S-O-U-L, in all of us. So, we're going to have 3 hours with Erica to drop deep into this topic. So, thank you, Erica.
Carol is a manifestation of everything she just said. Welcome. Oh, good if I put my paper in the right order. have a lot of material today as usual, so, and we'll see how it comes out because it always comes out differently every time. So as I feel like we have lost an understanding, a connection with a feeling of both the masculine erotic soul and the feminine erotic soul. I think we are, as who phrased this? I think Rachel Hillel phrased it as, we are orphans in this way. My mother certainly had no connection with her feminine erotic soul, and my father had little connection with his masculine erotic soul. So, but I think it is more easy to stand up here and talk about the generative phallus and the masculine soul and the masculine power and the masculine eros than it is to stand up here and talk about the vulva and the feminine erotic soul, because it has been so maligned and dissociated and disparaged in our culture. So I'm going to take a stab at it. Okay. So what I would like today is to watch. I have some amazing films, I have some amazing pictures, I have lots of material, and I would like us to really try to tune in to how we're reacting, how we're experiencing this material, because that's the important thing. If we can talk about this stuff, we can talk about all this Jungian stuff forever and be in our heads and not have any transformation happen. So you have to come down, you have to come into your experience. I'm going to try to give you some things that will help you do that. Okay. So what I want to ask us today, because I don't like to just stand up here and go blah, 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 blah. I want us to all be thinking and playing with this together. What is the feminine erotic soul in men and women? Where is it? Where is it gone? And why do we need it? Okay. So, my personal journey with this probably started in 1970, when I didn't get into the college of my choice. And I said to my parents, I'm either going to Haight-Ashbury, I'm going to Paris, you choose. I said, oh, Paris. So off I went by myself to Paris, a very, very naive, young, vulnerable 18-year-old, and had quite many adventures, as you can imagine, and began to learn a little bit about the world and my feminine erotic soul and many other things. And then I was on an internship in Mexico in 1975, and once again, you know, I love New England, but we have a real problem with the feminine and the masculine erotic soul. So I find in other countries it's a little more easy to sort of feel into it. So I went to Mexico on an internship, and once again, I felt much closer to the feminine. Now, that doesn't mean there's a ton of misogyny. There's a ton of misogyny everywhere. But the colors and the music and the culture just has, Spanish itself, it's one of my favorite languages. It has a rhythm, it has language, and it has music in it. So, and I remember one of the last things I bought in Mexico was a beautiful frilly blouse. And I came home and it went into the closet. And I went, what happened? So then I moved to Texas in 1980. And Texas, talk about misogyny, my God. But Texas, again, it has this beautiful culture of, it's very earthy, it's very primal. It has an amazing culture of Hispanic, Black. And the feminine there is very repressed in many ways, but it's also comes out in the colors and the jewelry and the sparkly. It's very sparkly. And I remember I was working on my own sexuality, of course, as we always do, and I was walking with a friend down the street in Houston, and she said, Erica, do you realize that men really look at you? And I went, no, because I didn't. And I started working on that and thinking about it, and then I realized it was okay. Finally, it was okay that I could be viewed as a woman, as a sexual woman, and I was okay, I was safe. I could be safe with that and just be in that space. So those are some of my early experiences with this. And I'm sure some of you have had experiences various ways. Now, I'm not talking about sex, per se. That's not the point. Sex is part of it, of course. What I'm talking about is, what is the feminine erotic soul? What do we feel? What do we, how do we experience in ourselves? It's not about another person. It's about ourselves. How do we open to it? Okay. So Jung said, John Doerly wrote Jung and His Mystics. It's an amazingly dense book. It's wonderful. And he wrote, Jung's myth taxes humanity with the birth into consciousness of the archetypal powers of the Great Mother. That really was his mission. That really was his journey. How did he connect with the feminine? And there are many, many stories of that. A moment of dissolution in the Great Mother's world makes the birth of consciousness less painful and serves to guarantee the survival of the child and the species. That's a pretty powerful message. This is Jung. Sexuality is not mere instinctuality. It is an indispensable creative power that is not only the basic cause of our individual lives, but a very serious factor in our psychic life as well. Mm-hmm. I believe only in the Word become flesh, as in the Bible, the Word become flesh, incarnation, in the spirit-filled body. Jung says, with the honey of the senses and the joy of life, the healing and the whole-making medicine, which is recognized even by modern psychotherapy, is combined with the spiritual and conjugal love. The whole of conscious man is surrendered to the self, the new center of the personality. Feel free to have a dialogue with me, to ask questions, bring up points, because I don't like to just talk at you. I like us to have a dialogue. Okay, I'm gonna go into some of the history of the goddess, but specifically focusing on the erotic and throughout history, and bring it up to the present. And then I'd like us to open it up. Who are our feminine erotic icons now? And where do they fall short? Where do they, you know, what is that about for us, all of us? Okay? But first, we're going to watch a movie. I'm going to try to get us into it a little bit. What I want you to do with this is I want you to just be open to it. Just allow it to come in and see what happens inside of yourself. Thank you. powerful piece. Cirque du Soleil. So let's not think about it. I want you to analyze it. Just what came up for you as qualities that this speaks to?
Crucifixion.
Crucifixion. You felt odd?
Odd.
And
anxious.
Strength.
Strength?
Wild body.
Powerful?
Wild body.
Wild body?
Beauty.
Wild beauty.
Yeah.
Okay.
But, okay. Yeah.
Uninhibited.
Uninhibited.
Tragedy.
Self-contained.
Self-contained.
Tragedy.
Tragedy.
Birth.
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 Vulnerability.
Vulnerability.
Fluid.
Fluid. Sensuous.
Yeah, I was just in awe.
Just in awe.
Of the discipline of the beauty of the body. I was in Turkey and saw a whirling dervish, and it kind of reminded me of this. Kind of my conscious mind just left and was somewhere else viewing it.
Yeah, so it took you sort of into a subtle body place.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So we're talking about the sacred feminine erotic soul. Right? Okay. Any other?
Extravagant.
Extravagant.
Essential.
Essential?
Essential.
Ascension.
Joy.
Potential death for the sake of art.
Potential death for the sake of art. Risk.
Erotic.
Yeah.
I heard one. What?
Inspired.
Athletic.
Open.
Open.
Trained.
Okay. So what specifically in the feminine erotic soul? So we're talking about open, vulnerable. I mean, all these strong. It's not a weak thing at all. It's incredibly powerful, right? But there's a different quality than the masculine. Quality. Of course, she has masculine too. She wouldn't be able to do this if she didn't have that. But it's married with the feminine. Okay. Any other thoughts about that? Yeah.
Well, I felt like when she was up high, she was able to cover herself with the red and be protected, and then she was like peeking out, and she, the whole thing was a process of gradually coming down and touching the ground, and that there was a lot of pain in that for her. Like, she was safer up high. And I just felt really moved.
And the three, I see them as the three priestesses who come and then take her and hold her and help her come back.
The choice of music was so strongly colored. My experience of it.
Let me fall, let me go. It's the music. It's in French.
And the colors, the red.
Yeah, the colors. Yeah. Mary Magdalene always wore red. Okay. All right. So let's go way, way, way back, 100,000 years ago. 100,000 years ago, when the goddess was the most supreme power in the world. The males were consorts of the goddess. So the earliest stone statues, like here, from the Black Sea to the Adriatic and then Anatolia, Turkey, that area, they bury, this is the earliest one, $800,000 ago, probably is worth that. 800,000 years ago, 35,000 to 25,000 BC. Very, very long time. And at about 10,000 years ago, which is very recent history, is when the horse-riding pastoral patriarchal tribes of the north came in and destroyed the clan kinship structure of the people, and were organizing as a social, that was a social principle, and
And back then, the high priest, there was high priestess, and then she was the top ruler, and then the queen and the brother or uncle were the consorts for the king and queen of the region. So let's go through some of these. So this is the most ancient. Then we, everybody recognize this one?
Mm-hmm.
Venus of Willendorf. Mm-hmm. This is 30 to 25,000 BC, 1,000 years ago. Anybody know who this is?
Mm-hmm.
Who made this? 1977.
Yeah.
Judy Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
I never seen that from her before.
No,
I didn't. This is from Malta. She's pregnant. This is 3600 to 2500 BC. This is Egyptian, the vulture goddess, 4200 to 3400. This is the Aztecs, Quetzalcoatl. Fertility, life, death, rebirth. The mother of the gods, the skirt of snakes. The goddess is very connected to the snake. Whenever you see a snake, it's about the mother god, the great mother. This is from Sweden, the snake witch. This is 4 to 600 AD. Nigeria and Ireland. This is the 11th century. You see, so what from these pictures, what stands out to you? What is it?
Fertility.
Creation.
Female body.
What?
The female body.
The female body, yes. The vulva and the breasts. But the vulva, we're used to seeing breasts, but the vulva. The vulva is the yoni. It's the seed, it's growth, it's the creatrix. It's the creating from ourselves, not from somebody else. It's creating from ourselves. It talks to life's affirmation, desirousness, and ecstatic passion, erotic sensual soul passions. It's an initiation into her sacred rites. So let's say we take a bath. We take a beautiful bath with candles and salts and warm water, and we just allow ourselves to be immersed in the bath. Rituals that it sends participants, as you were talking about, into the subtle body, into the sublime sacred, through the erotic sensual passion. The human body is the shrine itself. It's the holy container, regeneration through sexuality, but not just through base sexuality, through the whole sexuality, tantric, subtle body. It's holy communion in these goddesses. Sexuality is not owned by humans. People offered themselves to the generative powers of the goddess to rekindle the sacred sparks of life. In an immature lover, love serves us. In a mature lover, we serve love. That was interesting to get your head around, or your heart around. We serve love.
Yeah. Who says that?
I think that was actually Nancy Coles Corbett.
Would you repeat it?
In immature love, love serves us. In mature love, we serve love. These are three books that I recommend that are really beautiful and fairly simple. The Redemption of the Feminine Erotic Soul by Rachel Hillel. I'm looking at the book. And Uncursing the Dark by Betty Niedorf. And then my supervisor for my training was Nancy Qualls Corbett, who wrote The Sacred Prostitute. These are a little more, this is a little more heady. These two really get into the feeling of it a little bit more. So, a dream. It's amazing when you read dreams of things like this. The analyst always finds the perfect dream to illustrate something. You know, so this is a beautiful, perfect dream. This was a woman, a physician, strict Catholic upbringing. She dreamt. Four proselytizers approach her childhood home. Whoops, I'm sorry. That's the wrong one. This is another dream. I enter a cave. A dark but dim fire is in the corner. There's a female Paleolithic Venus. There's a rapid alteration. Please turn off your cell phones. There's a rapid alteration from black to white in this Venus goddess. I am naked. She paints my whole body with ritualistic symbols. I experience erotic sensations as she proceeds to paint all over. And as she worked on this dream, the black was an aspect of the sacred prostitute, and the white was the sacred priestess. So she had both these in this figure that she was trying to integrate and bring together. Okay. Is this from India? So what is most vivid in these pictures? What aspect of the anatomy is most vivid?
The breast.
And then?
The vulva.
And the vulva is the outer as well as the inner part of the sexual parts. So, but here the vulva really stands out. It's as important as the breasts. If a religious attitude returns to the earth, the women, all of us, will regain our self-respect, our instinctual ways, also the meaning of religion. The way of our loving comes from our inner core. Our sexuality is love, is prayer, is spirituality. Okay. So that in Anatolia Plain and Egypt, the person who discovered and who unlocked the secret of these ancient goddess figures was Marija Gimbutas. Anybody know Marija Gimbutas? Okay, yeah, she's wonderful. And she was an archaeologist, and she was working in the States, and these figures were being unearthed, and she began to work on them. And the men were just talking very analytically about them. But she came from Lithuania, where she had a very deep connection within her culture of myth and the goddess and folklore and the mythology of the earth. And so as she was looking at these figures, she began to recognize elements that she had grown up with. And she was the one who said, no, this is the feminine, this is the goddess. These are goddess figures. These are the feminine erotic goddess figures of Paleolithic times. And she was right. People fought her for a long time, but she was absolutely right. There's a book of hers over there. So she has thousands of these little figures that came, that were unearthed. And that was the goddess culture zenith was 5000 BC. It was old Europe. And then we move to the Middle East, the Inanna, Ishtar, all the Mesopotamian, Babylonian, Sumerian goddesses. And that's 3500 BC or before. Ishtar was in Sumeria, Inanna was in Mesopotamia. Are any of these names familiar?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, some of them are, some of them aren't. And these were very powerful goddesses in terms of the rituals. They were the priestesses in the city-states, in the regions. They were the highest spiritual power. And the first writer to 2300 BC was a priestess named Inhe-Duana, meaning Inanna, and she was the religious head in Sumer. And this is our first recorded poet, and she says, "You have gathered the holy essences tightly on your breasts. Like thunder, you roar over the earth. You are a flood descending from the mountain. Your fire blows about and drops on our nation. You are in all our great rites." And in Inanna's song, the Song of Inanna, "My vulva, the horn, the boat of heaven, is full of eagerness like the new moon. My untilled land lies fallow. Who will plow my vulva?" What do you think? What do you feel?
The first poem invokes a lot of destructive images.
Mm-hmm. Or powerful images.
Well, flood and fire. And
mm-hmm. Yeah.
These would be typical, I would think, destructive mm-hmm. forces in
mm-hmm.
a culture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's interesting because in the early mythologies, the gods and goddesses were not so separated out, like Aphrodite and Artemis, and all the Greek goddesses are just different parts of the psyche. But in the early, early mythologies, they are very complex. You take one god or goddess and they involve both the destructive and the healing, both the sky and the earth and the underworld. So they're more they're more related to the shamanic connection of that world.
I have to say, just for curiosity's sake, it's interesting. I saw beauty and fluidity, and so interesting how we perceive, you know, because I didn't see destruction at all. So I just have to say that.
Mm-hmm.
It's fascinating.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. So Inanna and Ishtar were called the harlots of heaven.
Mm-hmm.
The harlots of heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Harlot has changed its meaning.
Mm-hmm.
I when I gave this talk somewhere else, a woman said, "What do you mean it's changed its meaning? It's never changed its meaning. Words don't change their meaning."
Mm-hmm.
But it has. The harlots of heaven, of course that's a translation, but the harlots of heaven, meaning that this is the priestess. The priestess is the Hari, the spiritual ruler, and she is a prostitute of compassion. One principal personality of Ishtar, she was the Har, the mother of the harlots, the mother of the harlots.
Mm-hmm.
The priestess Kadeshi means not to be touched. And in Hebrew, zona means harlot, and mezon means food. And rachayim means compassion, and rechem means uterus.
What does harlot mean?
It means the mother of harlots, har, and, this is harlot. This
well,
is what harlot
I'm wondering, what's a harlot? We're using the word harlot.
Uh-huh, yeah.
So what is a harlot?
Well, I'm describing it. So.
Okay.
Through these other etymological, so compassion, uterus, sacred prostitute, Kadesha, and holiness, divinity. Hadish is a saint. So these are all the attributes of the sacred harlot. Herdoel in Greek means sacred priestess. Hieros is sacred, I-E-S is passion. In Hebrew, Putza means harlot, Peretz means breakthrough, Hitperetz, an eruption, an excitement or outburst. In Latin, to venerate means reverent worship. Veneres means love and sexual desire. So these were the sacred prostitutes that Nancy Qualls Corbett talks about. They were the ones who invoked the goddess. They were the ones who created the rituals and the rites that took you into the sublime oneness with the goddess. And it was through sexuality, but it wasn't just mundane sexuality as we think of today. It was all in temples and in with sacred rites and with beauty and the importance of taking you to that place to renew your connection to the Great Mother, to renew your connection to the goddess.
Mm.
Any thoughts about that? Yeah.
Well, I'm lacking because I missed the first maybe 15 minutes,
mm-hmm.
and so I don't really know what you talked about.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm wondering if sexuality was used as a reward at some time when we started having civilization and sacred prostitutes or harlots or goddesses, whether from remembering Gilgamesh a little bit, I had the thought that sometimes these temple prostitutes, or the way it was talked about, was that sex was a reward for fighting or obeying. Is that true at all in any of the things that you've observed?
No, that wasn't the point. It wasn't a reward, no. Gilgamesh is actually a bit later myth than some of the stuff we're talking about. Okay, these are earlier myths. It was, remember, the sacred prostitute, the priestess, was the religious head of the state. Was the religion. She was it.
Once there was a state, And the state.
Then things did begin to shift. You're right.
I mean, before the state, there was just hormones and sexuality.
Wait. Hold on. Before the state, there was before the invasion of the patriarchal tribes.
Okay.
There was the goddess. That was the religion. It was
There were female images. There were things that were made, but we don't have any writings saying what these.
We do. That's what I was reading.
Well,
Carol.
Excuse me, but I've explored a lot of things, and I've done past life regression to that period of time, and it's an entirely different psychological state. It's nothing like what we know today, unless you get through it through Tantra or past life regression, but to really know it is to keep in mind that it's an entirely different psychological state.
And that's what I'm trying to help you sort of feel into a little bit. We can, you know, we have all our modern problems and our modern issues around this, and what has been done, what has changed from the sacred harlot, the sacred prostitute who initiated us into the goddess, into the womb of the goddess, to renew ourselves and to find our own feminine power, whether we're a man or a woman, it doesn't matter.
That word renew, there is, to go into that state is healing.
Yes, it
and
is.
We don't understand that. Well, some people do in the present. Tantra understands it. But renew is a very important word.
Let's go back to the beginning. Jung's myth taxes humanity with the birth into consciousness of the archetypal powers of the Great Mother. A moment of dissolution in her world. That's what we're talking about with the sacred rites of the sacred prostitutes. You know, I really want to use that word because it is really, it is the sacred that they were the religious leaders, okay? A moment of dissolution in her world makes the birth into consciousness less painful and serves to guarantee the survival of the child and the species. Mm-hmm. So yes, this is a very different mindset than we have in modern life. Just look at some of these images. Okay? And how do we come back to this in a very healthy, holistic way? How do we renew our connection to the sacred energy of the earth, of the underworld, of the earth, of the flower, of the cosmos? You mentioned tantra yoga, tantra. This is Kali. Tantra came from shamanism, actually. It's a very, very ancient root into shamanism. And tantra in Sanskrit means the fabric of the universe, which includes eroticism, sensuality, femininity, and the power of destruction. Kali renews and destroys. Shiva renews and destroys. It's a magical technique that exerts an influence on the world of polarity, of the masculine and feminine. It brings us into unity. Enlightenment is a normal characteristic of our nervous system. We don't have to, as the meditation teachers keep telling us, we don't have to do anything. It's right here. That's the hardest thing to be, isn't it? Right here. And being right here in the present moment is to be with nature, totally with nature, to be totally with the earth, to be totally with out of time, out of chronos, linear time.
How long ago was Kali?
She's way back. I don't know exactly, but way, you know. She's in the beginning. She was the one who was called upon by Durga to help conquer the demons. Okay. Enlightenment is a normal characteristic of our nervous system. It's similar to an orgasm, enlightenment. Of course, it's not just an orgasm. It just keeps going and going and going. It's an orgasmic experience of light, diving into and becoming one with the primordial, the oceanic liberation of the self. It's a profound understanding of life and death, of the past, of the present, and the future. Have you ever had an experience of you sort of get into this wonderful subtle body state that we were sort of mentioning before, and into the subtle body space, and suddenly you just have a feel, you feel more able to sense what's going to happen in the future, or you know how to follow your own little instinctive way. You aren't so pulled by the culture and by what you should do and what you need to do and all that. That's what we're looking for, that moment when we're one in ourselves and we can just proceed as one in ourselves. And that's why when I was in Houston and I got to a place where it's okay if I'm a sexual woman and that's what people see, I'm safe. I'm one in myself. Durga or Kali travel in the body of the woman. And here, I think it's always interesting in tantric yoga, the different root chakras, the different chakras are talked about in different ways and different systems. But I like this, what they said here. The root chakra is where Shakti develops. Shakti is the female aspect, the female and the male union of the Kundalini. And she's the female. Only when we satisfy sexual desire and emotional need, that doesn't mean we go out to prostitutes. That doesn't mean we have all the sex we can want. That means we come into our sexual connection with ourselves. Okay. Desire and emotional needs. Can we develop spiritual strength that can flow into the crown chakra? So you can't just go up and have energy in your crown chakra if you don't have the bottom, because you will probably go crazy. Mm-hmm. You have to have the whole system. It has to work together. You have to have the grounding in order to have the up. You have to have the underworld in order to have heaven. Mm-hmm. That's something we totally miss. Remember that hell, the underworld did not become hell until the New Testament. It was just the underworld. It was where many, many gods and goddesses lived and where you went after death, and it wasn't a place of punishment. Place of being. It was just another experience, another level of experience. So, and the second chakra is the sexual genital, and it's the energy center of the human being, according to the shamanic view, where the nutrition is transformed into energy and where the organic system is detoxified. Isn't that interesting? The organic system is detoxified. The third chakra is the navel. It's the protective shield. That place where we feel like we can protect ourselves. The heart is where we build relationships. The throat is where shamans left their bodies and traveled, where they had out-of-body experiences. This is the Bun tradition in Tibet, which is related to Tibetan Buddhism. It gives energy and it brings us into resonance with the environment and energy to the intellect. The third eye is the relationship to the gods. Stores cosmic wisdom, and then the crown is the transpersonal cosmic energy. So just remember that if you don't have the ground chakra, I've had experiences when I've had energy move up, subtle body experiences which were so powerful, if I stood up too fast, I would fall over. You have to have the grounding, and then you can transmute and work with the whole system. Okay. So these were the sacred prostitutes that helped us get there through ritual, through touch, through sexuality, but it wasn't just going to a prostitute. There were in those cultures the sacred priestesses, maybe I'll use that word, it simplifies it a little bit, right? And then the profane prostitutes. And they were both part of the culture, but when you wanted to get in touch with the divine, you went to the sacred harlot. Yes.
Did women go as well as men? Do we know that?
Well, that's an interesting question. I think more that women at certain points in their life went to the temple and became, they were part of the ritual. In the Dionysian ritual that I spoke of a couple of times ago, that's where the women went specifically with the Dionysians. So yes, there were rituals, which I'll talk about a little bit. That were specifically for women themselves. Okay. time for another movie. Okay. This is a silly little film, but the scene is just so lovely. It speaks to what we're talking about, the sacred prostitute, the sacred priestess.
I started dancing and I thought found I really liked it. It made me happy.
Yes, it shows. I mean, I feel excited about something for the first time in such a long time. Aren't you?
Excited?
About tomorrow, the competition.
No, 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 I'm petrified. I'm gonna forget everything. I won't be able to put one foot in front of the other. I'll make a mess of the whole thing.
No.
I know, I'm just...
Give me 1 hour. Leave it. Take the light. Don't say anything, and don't think. And don't move unless you feel it.
I loved being in this creative process and finding these TV clips. They just sort of come along.
Which movie was that?
This is called Shall We Dance. It's a little movie about the transformation of Richard Gere, who's having a middle-age crisis, and this dancer who got left by her dance partner and is in a real bad place. And it's really sweet. It's a sweet movie. So, what did we feel there? What's going
sexy.
On here?
Wow.
Sexy. Yeah.
Sexy babe.
And I don't mean, your question is very important. It's like, how do we get into this material beyond our, you know, what has happened, right? How do we move into
I
that?
I
yes.
When she said, beautiful. Leave the lights, don't talk, don't move unless you feel it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was so lovely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Laura.
Well, I really felt that process of initiation with him, where they were two, and she initiated him into this unity within himself,
mm-hmm.
that became the unity between them.
Yeah. Did you hear that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's a beautiful way of putting it. Yeah. Was there healing for both of them?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
What else? Yes.
One thing that I find, especially with tangos, is that when the woman submits, but in submitting also obtains a power,
mm-hmm.
through the submission.
Mm-hmm. And there's really a submission for the man too, right?
That's,
he has to submit,
yes,
to his own instinct.
Yes, yes, yes.
And when they both submit to their own instinct and their own sensuality, they can move as one.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Right.
Yes.
The tango is lovely that way because the power moves back and forth.
Yes.
And you can see the power.
There are moments when he leads and moments when she leads, and it's a real dialogue.
Mm-hmm. It was sexual without being sexual. You know what,
yes,
I mean? It was more in this other zone.
Uh-huh.
I guess you'd call it sensuous. I don't know. But you know, in our culture, it's either one, or once you're sexual, then it means a certain thing.
Right.
This was in a whole other realm.
Yes. And that's what we're trying to hone in on, this other realm. It doesn't mean, I mean, yeah, go ahead.
For me, it was a sense of whole body connection with themselves and then merged together.
Yes, yes, yes. What do people feel?
More alive.
More alive. Yeah. I always get teary when I see this. It just makes me want to cry.
Don't you get aroused? Do
me?
You get aroused?
It's a different than like sexual, like I
would
have been.
I didn't just mean physical.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's more like there's an arousal of sort of a subtle body place with the emotional. You know, it's just a mix, beautiful mix of sensuality, I think. Which is, yeah. I mean, if we don't have the sensual aspect, then sexuality is kind of dead, isn't it? We can have sex, but who cares? Any other thoughts? Yeah, sure.
Well, I think the tango also plays with death.
Mm-hmm.
And that it's very, very exciting in the dance to do that.
Mm-hmm. It's so also sublimated violence in it, too.
Yeah.
By what?
Yeah.
Yes.
It's also a sublimation of violence in the dance as well.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This power,
you see,
so
you
power.
See all these different energies in it, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
The sensuous, the power, competition, the drive, the, you know, all of it, yeah,
mm-hmm.
which is what the goddess has, all of it, yeah, Daniel.
Well, when you were saying about, like, we raise these energies and we often think, oh, this means that,
mm-hmm.
meaning, oh, this means they must now be a couple.
Right.
And that we literalize the forms and how that prevents all the other ways in which this energy could go,
mm-hmm.
into so many other kinds of things.
Absolutely.
So there's a whole, like, oh, well, I don't want to do that, so then I can't do this.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it stops the whole chain of where the energy flows. And the other thing is that, okay, he's a man and she's a woman, but if they're switching roles,
mm-hmm.
they're switching genders moment to moment.
Exactly.
And so that's also not literalized what
right.
gender you're in.
Yeah.
And I loved at the end that the sense of there was something about the energy coming up and then she was looking down, so the up and down energy was evoked. But the fact that you can go back and forth means that you're participating in the middle, and now the middle is strong, and
yeah.
now it exists between
it holds the center.
Holds the center.
It?
But you have to do that by being able to cross it,
mm-hmm.
thus it exists.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. So here's the initiation. Here's the ritual. Here's the rite.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and we can find it in many places in our culture, dance. Anybody else have some thoughts? Yeah.
Well, this was a scene written, directed, paid for to show us this.
Mm-hmm.
I feel that our culture, religion, most importantly, has repressed sexuality.
Absolutely.
So we have to watch it.
Yeah.
We have to find it somewhere. That's
right.
Why porn is so great on the internet, because in order to work and wear a tie and get dressed and do what they want us to do, we have to repress everything.
Right.
So repression comes from a strong culture. To build the monuments, when we have these goddesses, they had to repress people. That's why I think, and I'm just beginning my research on this, that temple prostitutes were, in a sense, a reward. This is from just from my reading and interpreting old writings. So I'm saying older cultures that were not controlled to make empire.
Right.
Sexuality is natural. You don't think about it. You're not even aware of it. You are unconscious of it.
Mm-hmm.
You are unconsciously satisfied.
Mm-hmm.
Native Americans, I just read, never raped the white people. There was no case of rape of Native Americans against the colonials.
Mm-hmm.
Yet, sexuality is natural. It's completely, I'm just saying, I've experienced completely unconscious. Your
right.
body doing something where,
okay.
completely unconscious. So all of this that we're talking about actually comes from repression or control. So that's why we need all this. That's why we have to learn about it or unlock it or
yeah,
be
that, that's why,
trained.
That's why Jung was wanted to bring it to for us to connect with it. Absolutely. Because he wants us to go beyond the patriarchy. And we don't, you know, we don't really want to go back to the matriarchy either. We want a sacred marriage. Wait. This isn't about gender. This is about the masculine and feminine energy in the universe and our lives and what we do with both of those. Right. So we're looking at the feminine aspect because that has been much more repressed, I think. But we want the sacred marriage. We want the hieros gamos. That's what we're reaching for. But we have to reconnect with the energy in order to get there. So let me go on a little bit, okay? Yes, this is very important how it's gotten, but I don't want to just focus
just
on that.
Just one more thing. You said sacred marriage. I'm saying sacred community. It was community first. There was tribe. There was
right.
clan.
Mm-hmm.
So
okay.
So in sacred marriage, now with everything controlled in our lives, we have to come up with all of this.
Well, that's what we're doing, right? Yeah.
But
we don't have to come
I'm
up
saying,
with it.
If I omit being in this culture, I don't have to do all that. I already have it.
Okay. Yes, Charles.
May I get back to this?
Sure. Get back to this.
I'm really drawn to his expression.
Uh-huh.
Right
there. Yeah.
My relating to that is that he said, "What the hell just happened?"
What the hell? Wow. Where was I?
What just happened? And totally flabbergasted with this loving, wonderful web was weaved around him and just carried him across the floor. I think, she was from my experience, she was in total control. She initiated it, she ended it with love. Now I don't mean control in an aggressive way, but just like a web, a beautiful, loving web.
They were both in the web, weren't they?
Yes.
And they both, she got him in touch with the web, and then they could move within the web of life. So that's the sacred marriage, really, when the web is there and we're in it, right?
It was interesting that that first film you showed, she was entwined.
Uh-huh.
Her whole dance was in this entwining, in this relationship that she had. And then all of the different figures you show are actually shown as entwined figures.
Mm-hmm.
And then this entwining of the dance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So good. So we have the ancient goddesses, and then of course the patriarchal comes in. So in the Greek, there's one of the early, and this is pre-Greek, but I have the information from the Greek culture. There's the Thesmorphia, and this happened in all cultures. I'm sure I haven't been able to research all cultures in the world. It would take a lifetime. This is before Zeus. And we have votive remains of this, so we know this happened. It's about 6,000 BC. And what it had to do with was the women going and fertilizing the fields, which they did every spring. And it was only women, this is a woman's ritual,
And there were 3 days of preparation, the purification, the separation from the community that they were in, and drinking of the herb that would help them menstruate together. So if you're in a community, most women are menstruating together anyway. So they come together in the fields, and the men are not allowed. In fact, if they enter, they will be perhaps killed. I mean, that's how powerful this was. You did not go. Day one, there was a sacrifice to the snake deity. The snake deity is the mother goddess in an underground chasm. And Erishkigal, who is the goddess of the underworld, becomes the snake. She's the snake. And in day two, there's a silence and fasting, and they eat pomegranate seeds. Demeter and Persephone. Demeter was the mother goddess, and Persephone, her daughter, was abducted by Hades, the underworld god, and became the goddess of the underworld. But in order for her to come back and go back and forth, her mother wanted her back, and Hades said, well, eat 6 pomegranate seeds, please. So she did. So she can come up for 6 months, and she goes down for 6 months, and that's where the seasons come from. So the second day was eating of the pomegranate seeds and carrying of the sacred images, which included the masculine, the penises, coiled snakes, and presenting them to the snake goddess, and then menstruating on the fields themselves. And then the fast was broken. And this is kind of the interesting place, because when the fast is broken at sunset, they begin to laugh and cry and scream. This is quite cathartic, right? Mm-hmm. Sounds like we should do that every year, right? And go, and they would just say all the things that were forbidden and all the places that they were in pain and all the terrible things that happened, and rage and laugh and fight. And this was called the snake's tongue. They were just letting it out. They were just purifying themselves emotionally and cutting away their pride, just let it go, cutting away their pride and desire. And then they would go into a very deep sleep, I can imagine. And day three, they would wake up singing. They would be singing the ancient songs, singing the songs of the ritual. And the elders would speak of the snake's departure back into the world, back into the underworld, so that they were planting the seeds, and they would sing and plant the seeds and fertilize the field. And that was an incredibly important ritual for women. And then we also have the Eleusinian mysteries in Greek, where Demeter and Persephone, and you would go down, men and women both participated in this. You would go down into the cave and go to the phallus in the cave, the phallus in the womb. And the Villa of Mysteries, which what I spoke of before, is about Ariadne, and who's the wife of Dionysus. Dionysus is the god of ecstasy, the god of a mystical god, the god of madness. Ecstasy and madness can sometimes be close. I often, when I teach people to be candidates, I say, what's the difference between madness and transformative experience? What's the difference between madness and a mystical experience? Madness doesn't end. Absolutely. You don't know what to do with it. You get lost in it. It's the same place. It's the collective unconscious. It's the spiritual archetypal realm of the unconscious. But we have the center to be able to go there and come back, to be able to work with the energies that we pick up there, to transform in ourselves. That's the difference. Thank you, Dan.
There's one other comment.
Yeah.
Okay. I believe it's Joseph Campbell, who has this quote that I really like best.
Uh-huh.
The madman drowns in the same waters that the mystic swims in.
There you go. That's beautiful. The madman drowns in the same waters that the mystic swims in.
Isn't the key self-awareness?
What?
Isn't the key difference self-awareness? When we're mad, we're not really aware of
it. Yeah,
madness.
We've certainly lost the position of being able to witness, haven't we? In a way. I mean, you can go into tremendous altered states and not really know where you are. But, I mean, the first movie, the first scene, the first thing, she had to be in an altered state to do that. My God. She had to be in this incredibly powerful place, right?
And get grounded in her body.
Yeah, she had to be very grounded in her body. So is that sort of, is that what you're thinking of?
Yes, maybe I'm being oversimplistic, but somehow the way back seems to be through some sort of stand aside.
When we go into altered states, whatever ritual it happens to be, whatever, however we get there, we do, we need a ritual to come back, right? That's why ritual can be so important. It can create the space that's safe. But we do have to learn how to go in and out. Shamans, they go into a spiritual crisis. They begin to maybe be physically ill or emotionally unable to do anything, and they're taken in and they have to find their way through, and that's how they learn to do what they do, by finding their way through.
And that's Ariadne, right, with the thread?
Yes, Ariadne has the thread. She has the labyrinth with the minotaur, and she takes the thread in and helps Theseus go and kill the mad minotaur, and then they come out. Yeah.
So just to connect, like how we have polarities there in the dance, if you have, and when you say ritual, you talk about remembering something that's not here, so that's a polarity from what is.
Mm-hmm.
I think about like when you're swimming, you're breathing air right next to water, so you're in between the two worlds.
Mm-hmm.
So you have that dance of polarity of air and water.
Mm-hmm.
That if you can hold the two, then the third comes in, and then you can be a mystic.
Right.
And I also think about Narnia, where they talk about the ring of the world between the worlds.
Mm-hmm.
So any world you're in, you also have access to the world that's between the worlds. And any world is not all of it. It's just a world.
Right.
If you can remember that, you can come back.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes.
I was thinking about, it's made me think about when I was learning authentic movement with Janet Adler and this, both the sense of the witness, but I remember her saying something about an image of, like, imagining we were sort of tied to a tree as we went down and allowed unconscious to move us. And it always stayed with me.
Mm-hmm.
Something about the mystical without.
Yeah.
And staying grounded. There was like, you know, tied to a tree.
So this is the imaginal realm, which is part of all this, and how we use it to travel into states of connection with different parts of our psyche, right, and different parts of the world, and the erotic and the archetypal. Let's see. In the love goddess's cosmogony, erotic sensual energies were reconciled with reverent religiosity. Surrendering to sensual sexual desires was seen as a devotional path. A devotional path. Very different from our mindset, right? I mean, where do we find this? We don't. We have to find it personally. This is Artemis of Ephesus, many-breasted Artemis. She was the goddess of nature, of the wild animals. They all were in some ways, but that was her specific. All the goddesses, Aphrodite, Artemis, Hestia, they were all virgin goddesses, meaning that they had sex with lots of other mortals and immortals and whatever, but they were never tainted. They were always one in themselves. They remained virginal, so they didn't lose themselves. That's a good trick to remember.
What do you mean by tainted?
They didn't become wives. They didn't become, didn't take them into a negative place. They always could retain their own sense of self. Or husbands. But, you know, whatever we put on all that. Does that make sense?
Personal power.
They didn't lose their personal power. They didn't sell themselves to any particular way of being or what they should do or shouldn't do. They just remained true to their own nature.
They remained pure.
Pure, in that sense, yeah.
I'm sorry. Do you think that was the origin of the Virgin Mary?
The Virgin Mary goes way back, right? She's really the great mother. But she got.
But I was thinking in terms of, you were saying that Artemis and Aphrodite were essential, even though they had sexual mortals or whatever, but they were still virginal.
Yes.
And I was just wondering if that was sort of
Sure, all of this, all of these myths go way back. The Virgin Mary is the most the most recent patriarchal version of it. Okay, so this is, I love these pictures from the 1800s. Unfortunately, not many of them were painted by women because there weren't many women painters back then. And so, but this is Ariadne. This is the Ariadne before she wakes up, before Dionysus, she's abandoned on an island and Dionysus comes and they have the sacred marriage and they wed. So this is Ariadne. Who's this? The birth of Venus. I love this image of the birth of Venus because there's all this beautiful flow and sensuality and around her. So Aphrodite is the golden one, the moon goddess fertility. She's very ancient also. She's extremely ancient. And she wears the moon, the same moon as the crescent moon that Isis in Egypt wears. She's the honey, the dove, the Holy Ghost. All these goddesses are the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost. Isn't that interesting? I always liked the Holy Spirit. It was my favorite in that cosmology. Her birth is an act of love. When her mother and father, Uranus and Gaia, are merged and they're having babies and Uranus won't let them out. So Cronus, one of the sons whose time, splits them, separates them, and cuts off his father's genitals and throws it in the sea. So that's the birth of Venus, from Uranus's genitals and the sea. Into the stormy sea. And she's clothed by the hours. Isn't that beautiful? She's clothed by the hours. And Afro means foam, and the last part of her word means scallop or feminine genitals. And her husband was Hephaestus, who was a blacksmith. It's very shamanic, very early shamanic. Blacksmith and a hunchback and deformed, and he would mine and create these gorgeous jewels and shields and for the gods from the mountain. And her son was Eros. So a dream. This is a literature professor. She had the perfect persona, and she had crippling allergies. She could not go outside, and she had a tyrannical superego that was always telling her exactly what she should do and not. Was very controlling, and she had this dream. I'm sitting in an office writing my doctoral thesis. The building is surrounded by an exquisitely blooming garden. Suddenly, I became aware that a small statue of Aphrodite is waiting for me in the garden. I have never seen it before. I have a duty, an inner call to recover it. I must obey. Without caution, I descend to the garden, the forbidden zone. Heavily scented flowers and thick brushes, dainty, and among all this is the dainty statue. Instead of getting sick, I collect it calmly and carry it in. So in order to deal with her allergies and this horrible controlling aspect of her psyche, she needs to retrieve the Aphrodite from the garden. And then she dreamt, I'm teaching prostitution at the college. Okay, so there were a lot of this is William Blake, Adam and Eve, but I love the angel with the serpent. There's the goddess again, the serpent. And the serpent was the goddess in the book, in the garden. What did the goddess want us to do? In the garden? Mm-hmm. Know the difference between good and evil? Mm-hmm. And get out of there. Stop being taken care of. To find our own will, to find our own journey, to find our own sense of self. I love this. Mm-hmm. Cupid and Eros. Eros and Psyche. Mm-hmm. I can tell you who did all these, but we're all just doing right now. This is Lilith. Anybody know Lilith? Remember Lilith? So this is, we're getting into sort of, again, these goddesses are all very old, but Lilith was sort of more of a post-Greek myth, perhaps. And she was Adam's first wife.
Mm-hmm.
But she refused to be overshadowed by Adam. She refused to take the submissive position. And so she was banished from the garden. Well, she flew out of the garden, actually. And then God came and said, how dare you fly out of the garden? How dare you not be Adam's first wife? And she said, basically, too bad. And he cursed her. And she became a demon in Hebrew in the early rendition of her. And then in the Kabbalah in the 13th century, a lot of these early female goddesses were elevated back to their power and status. So she was a black goddess. A lot of these were. Black goddess, black is beautiful. Now, what does black mean in this context? Black means earth. Black means
the underworld.
The underworld.
Place.
Unconscious.
Instinct.
Yeah.
Laura?
Receiving.
Prima materia.
Prima materia. Right. Prima materia. It's the material that we that gets transformed in the process, right? Anything else? Black.
I thought this was an image of Rishkabat.
This is an image that different people say a little bit different things about. I've always known it as Lilith.
Okay.
Yeah. But you know they're similar, right? They come from the same root. Yeah.
Just a note as you're going through the different art images, the vulva seems to have disappeared.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
The pelvis has become very vertical.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you. That's
just
really important.
Noticing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We can still see breasts.
Yeah.
They're fine.
Right.
But the vulva is receding.
Yeah.
The black goddess. Black is beautiful. She was the female who could pronounce the magic word name of God, which was Verboten. So she had the power to pronounce the magic name of God. She has feet that are animal, and she has wings that are transcendent. She has the owls of wisdom. Lilu means underworld spirit, and Lil means light, which is very interesting. These polarities of light and dark in all of these figures. Okay. Here's another 1800 painting of Lilith with the snake. She is sometimes thought of as the serpent herself, who helped Adam and Eve get out of the garden.
Mm.
Mm. Okay. I couldn't find really good images of the Shekinah or the Shulamite, which are more Hebrew images of these, that again go way back to the first century AD. Shaka means act of dwelling, the presence of the glory, an aspect of the deity that can be felt by the senses. Receiving element. One rabbi says she is the light generating all forms of life. She is the fiery aspect of God. She is the sexual imagery and light to show the ray which emerges out of nothing. She is the celestial mother out of whose womb the creative energies, the Sephiroth, spring forth. In the Shekinah, the Shulamite, and Sophia, all of them have this myth of being somehow they created the world with God. They are equal to God. They and God, you know, it's the feminine aspect of the Godhead. And they are all somehow fallen or come down to earth. And they're in every one of us. They are the sparks in our soul. But they kind of get lost. And they did get lost in religion and myth, didn't they? We lost them. And again, in the 13th century, there was this incredible connection in Spain in the 13th century between the Sufis and the Judaism and Christianity that was just amazing. And that's where some of this, the feminine began to come back in the Kabbalah. Rabbi Shalom saying, we by the sexual act restore the deities to sacredness that was lost when Adam and Eve were exiled. So the Kabbalah restores her to the Holy Spirit. She's also the scintillae natura in alchemy, the little sparks in the darkness that bring it, that we need to connect with. She's in the sacred marriage, is the union of the soul with the Holy Spirit. In the Song of Songs, which was the Book of Wisdom, which was supposedly written by Solomon. You ravish my heart, my sister, my promised bride. You ravish my heart with a single one of your glances, with a single link of your necklace. What spells lie in your love, my sister, my bride? How delicious your love, more delicious than wine. How fragrant your perfumes, more fragrant than all spices. Your lips distilled wild honey. Honey and milk are under your tongue, and the scent of your garments is like the scent of Babylon. Mm-hmm. So it goes, Song of Songs goes on and on and on with this very ancient sexual imagery. So, and then the Shulamite seems to be, that's where I am beautiful, I am black but beautiful. She's the female manifestation in life of the earthiness. And the Song of Songs, some rabbis feel, is the dialogue between the Shulamite and her lover, this dialogue that goes back and forth. Thou still abideth so entirely one that we may know thy blackness is a spark of light inaccessible. Mm-hmm. So then...
Could you read that once more? The blackness is a spark of light inaccessible.
Thou shalt abideth so entirely one that we may know thy blackness is a spark of light inaccessible.
Inaccessible.
So, you know, in a lot of mystical traditions, the most powerful place is the void. It's mm-hmm. it's the blackness,
yeah.
It's the darkness. And in that darkness is where we find the eternal light. And then we go on to Sophia. I like this image of Sophia because here we have the goddess, the ancient goddess, which is what she's connected to. So again, she's the Holy Spirit, she's wisdom. Jung says about Sophia, she's the spirit of God. She is the feminine pneuman, the feminine spiritual energy. Her coexistence with Yahweh signifies the perpetual marriage from which the worlds are begotten and born. So you see, here we're getting a little bit away from the specific sexual imagery. It's more about giving birth and being the sexual partner, but through that, the birth. So it's interesting how these change as we go through the time. Mm-hmm. In the Nag Hammadi Library in the 4th century, which was found in the 1940s in Egypt, it was from the Alexandria Library, in the part Perfect Thunder, Perfect Mind, it says, for I am the first and the last, this is the goddess, the honored and the scorned one, the whore and the holy one, the wife and the virgin, the silence that is incomprehensible, the idea whose remembrance is frequent, the utterance of my name. Powerful, right?
It's also in that, by the way, a great image of the feminine in the sense, it's very Taoist. It says, I am below and they come up to me.
Mm.
Which is kind of an interesting mystical thing, but it's a very feminine Taoist idea.
Yeah, I mean, all these goddesses, you know, they were heaven and the underworld. But we sort of kept the heaven part,
mm-hmm.
but we lost the underworld part.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, if you look at a lot of Jungian work and Jung himself, we descend into the unconscious. We go down into nature. We go down into instinct. Okay. So this is another very interesting, this is a later image of Sophia. I just thought I'd throw that in. It's very powerful.
Love it.
Intense. She's not weak and wimpy. This is Mary Magdalene. Now, Mary Magdalene is an interesting figure, isn't she? I did a whole course on Mary Magdalene in Houston. She was actually the Jesus is, from what we know from the sacred scriptures of the Gospel of Philip and the Gospel of Mary Magdalene, she was Jesus' favorite disciple. She really got it. The other disciples were jealous of her. They're like, they didn't have their mystical connection. And in the Gnostic Gospel of Philip, he says, in the union of man and women dwells the relationship of Christ and the Magdalene, who it says was often kissed by him. And he was her most intimate. She was actually a very wealthy merchant. She was his patron, and she also preached. So back in the early church, women were equal to preachers. Women were equal. There wasn't a separation. That happened later, of course. She spoke who knew the all. She spoke who knew the all.
Mm-hmm.
she was labeled the a prostitute by Pope Gregory, Pope Gregory in 591. He gave a homily, and he insinuated that she had a lot of sin that was endemic to Adam and Eve. So that's how she became a prostitute. Let me read a...
It's so interesting because he was naming a truth, but he had, you know, he did the classic.
Yeah, he did the classic.
Reverse it, you know.
Patriarchal thing.
Yeah.
This is a dream. It's a physician who had a strict Catholic upbringing. There are four proselytes that approach my childhood home. They knock. Instead of a holy book, they give a sex education text. I'm startled, and I think sexuality is becoming a holy subject. Amazed, these illuminating books truly were eye-openers onto his spirituality, onto this woman's spirituality. And then we get, of course, we come back to the Virgin Mary, which is a very, very ancient time, over 20,000 years ago. She was a pregnant earth mother to begin with. Okay, any thoughts or... Should we take a little break? I have another movie and I have more material. Let's take a little bathroom break, okay? Okay. So this is yummy material, isn't it? It's very fascinating. Yeah, it's fascinating to try to trace it from its earliest places and how it's changed from where we are.
Yeah, you've done a beautiful job, I have to say.
Thank you. I've been adding to it for decades. So when I was in Houston, I gave a whole course on Mary Magdalene. It was when... what was Dan Brown's first movie? The Da Vinci Code. And I did a course on Beyond the Da Vinci Code. And I traced Mary Magdalene and the troubadours and the Vermingian bloodline and the Cathars and the Templars. And it was fun. So, you too. So Mary Magdalene is a fascinating creature. She was a true mystic with Christ. She was his patron. She was a creature. And there are very different aspects of her. And this, I love this one because it has the sexuality, but it has the mystical. And in her mystical guise, all she wears is her hair down to the floor. That's her garb. So here we have almost, it feels a little bit like a mystic of the desert, an ancient mystical being of the desert.
And her hand eyes, her hand is on her heart.
Yeah, her hand is on her heart. Yeah. And here's a vessel here, the feminine. But she's obviously sort of in some sort of mystical connection there. Okay. All right. Okay. The ritual of the Hieros Gamos is religious. The power of the instinct is recognized as belonging to the goddess. Her sexuality, her instinct are expressions of a divine life force. Esther Harding is a very early. So these are some of the just sacred images of the sacred marriage that come up in different texts. This is somewhere in the Middle East, I couldn't find it. Shakti and Shiva, India. More India. India has such profound imagery, doesn't it? We don't find any of that. This is alchemical. The philosopher and the wedding, the coming together, the fire between the masculine and feminine, the sun and the moon. This is from the Rosarium in the 1500s. It's a whole transformation of the relationship between in ourselves, between the masculine and feminine. And this is the particular alchemical text that Jung took began to conceptualize the whole transformational process of the transference between whoever we're in relationship to while we're transforming, the projections, what we project onto the other, and then how it's transformed within ourselves. Okay, so that's the Rosarium, has beautiful pictures. This is an older one. I like it because the serpent is mediating between the man and the sun and the moon, the king and the queen, the feminine and the masculine. Okay. And there seems to be an angel who's pouring out something from the alchemical vessel that has been cooking
What is the symbol over the serpent and on the vessel?
Well, it's, I think that's a, looks like a symbol of the masculine and the feminine. Yeah, so the union.
The masculine and feminine there look very similar.
Yeah, it's a little hard to tell. It's like one has a moon and one has a sun.
And astrology has a Mercury.
Masculine has a cannon next to him, thank you. And the feminine has a something.
And the one up on the top.
Amazing what we see as we continue to look at these images. Yeah, Daniel.
And just the one on the top seems like Aquarius. The water bearer and the star above, because the Aquarius is from the star.
Yeah, the, she has wings. She has wings, too. And the,
Mercury over the serpent.
Over the serpent, is that, okay, that's Mercury. You're right, thank you. Mercurius, of course, doll. Mercurius is the god of the alchemy. Okay.
And also some of, in Gimbutas's work, the bull imagery, which she thought was uterine. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's, so it's way before Mercury once again.
Mm-hmm. Well, Mercury is very ancient, right?
Yeah, but I think that is, I don't know. But I think that...
Well, all these images call forth preceding archetypal forms, right? They're all just, the archetypal forms are all the same. They're just being clothed in different ways, in cultural ways.
Exactly, and understood and projected.
Mm-hmm.
A myriad ways, which is the whole beauty of the underworld, right? Mm-hmm.
Okay. Here is one of my favorite things. Who is this? I think this is Berlinius. This is St. Teresa of Avila in her ecstatic trance.
Can we turn down some of the lights so we can see them?
Oh, okay.
Maybe these.
Okay, so I want to bring this up to the 12th and 13th century again, and in Dorley's book, Jung and His Mystics, he does an amazing job of talking to us about Jung's favorite mystics, and they were both women. They were the Beguines. The Beguines were women who in the, about 1000 AD did not want to go into convents. They did not want to become part of the patriarchal church. And they went out, there was a whole movement actually during that time. They went out on their own and they started their own enclaves. They started their own organizations. And they didn't, some of them were very wealthy and highly educated and some of them weren't. But, and eventually of course the Catholic Church came in and took them back. But the 12th and 13th century, they developed a spirituality and probably, and there are a lot of writing about the mystical marriage and bride mysticism was going on at that time. And Melchior of Magdeburg, I don't have any pictures of her, obviously, so I thought I'd put this up, was from 1207 to 82, and she had a very courtly upbringing, and she was, when she was 12 years old, she had an experience of the Holy Spirit, and she continued to have very powerful, wonderful experiences. And she wrote 7 books about it. And she is the most quoted mystic in Jung's entire collected works.
What's her name?
Mechthild of Magdeburg. She was Belgian. And Jung speaks of her experience as Christ eroticism. And when she was a teenager, Christ became her lover. And it was an eroticism as powerful as the roar of a hungry lion. And she says, "Oh Lord, ah Lord, love me greatly, love me often and long." More, the more she is loved, the more pure and into her own mystical place she becomes. Remember, the mystical union is not about me and them; it's about the one.
Do you think that was an orgasmic thing?
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Remember, orgasm is the mystical union. I mean, but not the profane.
Mm-hmm.
It takes us into that oneness, doesn't it? No matter how, she's in her book, no matter how high he dwells, his Godhead shall never be so distant that I can entwine my limbs with him, and so shall I never cool off.
Mm-hmm.
They're having hot sex.
Mm-hmm.
And this, the her books are a dialogue between the soul and the Holy Spirit. And this is very interesting. In order to attain this oneness and this sexual union with Christ, she must give up the virtues. That's pretty un-Catholic. She must give up her need for remorse and penance. She has to go against the patriarchy. She must give up her love of the world, and there has to be an annihilation of her self-will. She has to surrender. And she said, he has long wooed her. Her senses are enthralled. Her senses encourage her soul. Her sense, she has a dialogue with her senses, and they encourage her soul. And Christ leads her in a dance, and they surrender to each other, like the dance we saw. And she consciously submits to the unconscious. That's what she's doing. She's consciously submitting, going back into the womb of the Great Mother, really, with Christ, with the union of Christ. And it's the subtle body is the naked soul. The subtle body is the naked soul. Isn't that a beautiful way of thinking about it? Our naked soul, our vulnerable soul. And Mechthild said, divinity needs human intercourse to become self-conscious. That's an interesting thing, to become self-conscious. God has enough of all things save of intercourse with the soul. Of that he can never have enough. God has enough of all good things save of intercourse with the soul. He needs more of it. He can't get enough of it. Of that he never has enough. What do you think? Feel into that, huh? Yes.
Well, one of the really cool things I like about Mechthild is she, in her books, like it's kind of like reading about two people in a relationship the way she describes it, or about multiple beings in a relationship. And there's parts where, like, it is about the relationship between her and God, but also building her own relationship to herself and her own, I guess, feminine soul, really.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some parts, like some of it, it sounds really funny, but she'll, like, when she's not having basically like visionary experiences, there's times where she writes and she's really struggling, and then she'll have vision experience and be like, God, where were you? Like, it's been so long, you haven't called me, basically. And he, like, for the spirit talks to her and is, like, encouraging her to basically be with herself. And she, like, grows to become herself almost through realizing, like, learning how you were saying, like, to come out of the experience and to go back in and to not be, like, maddened either by being in it for too long or without it for too long also.
Right.
So it's like a very maturing process.
Yes, and it always is, isn't it? It's a very maturing process to be with the sacred feminine or the sacred whatever. But yeah. And, you know, the whirling dervishes, they just turn for 10 minutes. They go in, they flower, they turn, and they come out. They go in, they flower, they turn around their shape, and they come out. So it is very important, the threshold of learning how to go in, feel it, and come out, back to the world. And Jung never said go off in a cave and disappear. He said once you have an experience, you bring it back. It's your duty, it's your right, it's very important for the world to bring it back.
Is a comment?
Yeah, comment?
Well, just a background question. So the Greek gods and goddesses were archetypes, but the Jewish, Christian, Muslim god, is that an archetype?
Oh yeah, they're all archetypes.
Okay,
and
god
sort of
is an archetype.
It depends on where you...
God image.
Hmm?
God image. He's a goddess, not archetype. That's why I just said god image.
God image.
Well, it's the same. It's
the same. So God is an archetype.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. The archetypes are eternal. That, you know, Christianity has a particular flavor, and Muslim Islam has.
So there's nothing behind an archetype. It's in another level.
That's a really good question. There's a lot of debate about that. What is, where, you know, what is?
Can you repeat the question?
What is there something behind or beyond an archetype?
That's a very deep question. We'll spend another lecture on that, right, Judith? We can't experience an archetype full on, so it has to be closed. It has to be mediated for us, because the power of an archetype, when you have an experience of God, it's very, very powerful, right?
They say in the old Hebrew, you can't see God and survive the experience.
Right.
No one sees God.
These are primal. That's why I think in the beginning the imagery of the goddess is the roaring fire and the, you know, the volcano and all that stuff is speaking to that level of experience and the power of the earth energy, the power of nature.
It's interesting too. The physics of the creation.
Mm-hmm.
Is this, there was some canticle to the cosmos or something, but the power that, and this is just how, I mean, they say it, you know, physics has equations and numbers, and but the power comes in and becomes all this and keeps becoming
mm-hmm.
all this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, I think that, you know, aren't we all, well, I was always fascinated by black holes.
Mm-hmm.
What is a black hole? Mm-hmm. And as you read these mystics, there's another one I'll talk about. They had these powerful sexual transformative experiences where they were coming into themselves, and themselves meaning that the center of ourself is not just the ego, right? It's the archetype. It's the spiritual center. And after all these powerful experiences, they would go into these very dark, depressed places because God wouldn't call. and they had to go into a deeper level with the abyss, with the darkness, with the emptiness,
mm-hmm.
which is what everybody has to do when you're working with spiritual connection. There are the fecund times of manifestation and experience, and then there's the emptiness. And what's that? How do you make love to the emptiness? Okay. And his second favorite mystic, her name was Hadvik of Antwerp. She was also a Vedin. And she was waking up. And she had a very powerful place of authority, and then she was exiled as a Vedin. She's the 13th century, and she had a higher education. And at the age of 10, she had a passionate power, she felt the passionate power of God beyond the power of her humanity to sustain divine assistance. And her first vision was this passionate power of God beyond her power of humanity. And then she had 14 visions, and I think the last one was when she was 19. So you don't have very many visions, we hope, of this time. And her seventh vision was an eagle commands her to prepare for oneness. The three-year-old Christ offers his body and blood in a sacramental form, and then disappears and returns as a mature man and offers her the bread and wine. So first it's the blood and the blood and the body, and then it's the bread and the wine, and gives himself to her, and this is beyond her to countenance the abyss. She cannot connect with this abyss. She says, "My heart and my veins and all my limbs trembled and quivered with eager desire." And then she says, "And that kiss will be with one single mouth, and that fathoming will be with one single abyss. The voice of loud thunder, the noise of the highest unfaith, is the most delightful of love." After that, he came himself to me, took me entirely in his arms, and pressed me to him, and all my members felt his full felicity. Then it was as if we were one without difference. This is pretty racy language for back then. It sounds a little archaic for us, but back then. So what does that bring up for you?
took that we all have hormones and it's going to come out some way.
Well, that's for sure. We hope. But we hope it comes out in a beautiful, sensual, you know, wonderful, healing way, right? Or powerful way.
I think
way.
As long as the O is there, we're all set.
Okay. Yeah. How about this mystical connection through the sexual erotic sense?
Well, I think it's very similar to the sacred prostitute, attaining
yes.
oneness through sexuality.
Yeah, it's all the same. We're mm-hmm. just talking about different periods of it coming up and manifesting, mm-hmm. different forms, right? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I was thinking about how the sexual ecstasy is such a... There's such a, the veil is very thin there,
mm-hmm.
you know? There's such a line between who you thought you were and experience, whether it's with yourself or with an actual human lover or divine lover. But it seems that, I mean, she's, her face and her body here express it so perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
She has swooned.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's this mystic swoon where she's, it's like what you were saying about you don't survive seeing God. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
We don't survive. Something
mm-hmm.
else does.
Mm-hmm.
So I see
yeah.
that there.
And, you know, we could have a man here swooning.
Absolutely.
Right? It doesn't need to be a woman.
Absolutely.
This happens to be a particularly beautiful view of it. Yeah.
That's why death is like an orgasm.
Death is like an orgasm?
Hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I'm just noticing that it's hard to know where this is who initiated it.
Who initiates it? It's hard to know who initiates it.
Who initiated this
mm-hmm.
happening?
Mm-hmm.
You know, was it the surrender that brought it on, or was it the action that caused the surrender?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a really interesting question, isn't it? Always, what gets us there? Is it the are we the ones who surrender first, or are we touched?
Mm-hmm.
Does grace touch us? You know, can we make it happen? No. In the act of just sex, you can have a great time or you can have sort of a boring time, you know. But when we cross that threshold into the sacred sexual connection, yeah, you don't know. Here's a dream. This is a woman, a therapist who meets with her supervisor. I meet with a male supervisor, not in real life, in the dream. He's an honorable older psychiatrist whom I highly respect. I have a mini skirt on. I'm sleazy. The supervisor says, "You are a true healer." There's the sacred prostitute.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. This is another dream. This is a young teacher. She's very romantic and a bit repressed. My lover is chased by a group of men. They're apparently evil as compared to his innocent values. So this is her inner masculine. Evil and innocent. As he is chased away, he passes me a note which I hide in my vagina. I choose the vagina because it is a part of my body where I feel a lot of power. Okay, we're going to have another movie. Has anybody seen The Danish Girl? What an amazing movie. You saw her.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's me. It's an amazing movie of love and sensuality and finding oneself and courage. How many people have seen it?
Kindness.
Yeah, kindness.
Mm-hmm.
It's incredible.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't it get the Academy Award? It certainly.
She did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let this just come in and see what, after all this talk, we've done a lot of talking, let's see what comes.
Could you help me with something?
Anything.
Gola has an extra rehearsal. She canceled again.
Oh.
committee canceled.
What are you trying on, stockings and shoes? I'm just so behind, I don't know how I'll be finished in time for a rope with
it. I'll do it. It's fine, I'll do it.
There.
Down. He almost snagged it.
That's backwards.
So there's in the window at Fonsbeck.
Smart, aren't they?
Don't think they'll fit.
You do the best you can. Now I need the dress.
No.
I need to see
it. No, I'm not putting it on.
Well, I haven't asked you to. The sooner I start, the sooner I finish.
Thank you.
is on his journey to own his own feminine.
Mm-hmm.
So each one of these is a little further along.
This last one was, you know, in the end, he's almost shocked that he's a man. Very disappointed.
Yeah, very disappointed.
I was looking for more of this in Richard Gere. I didn't find much of it, but it was nice to see it come in full bloom.
It's kind of beautiful and heartbreaking to witness the disconnect from kind of that divine feminine within our society, within those societies, and to recognize that there's that hunger to kind of be in a relationship with ourselves in a deeper way that he's exploring. It's like really beautiful, and like I said, really heartbreaking too, to kind of see that internal struggle of not knowing how to find that balance or how to be held in one's own divine feminine.
Yeah, and he wasn't held in his culture. People are struggling to be held now. They aren't.
It brought up for me, it tied in with the first one, where embodying that feminine energy is dangerous. There's no place for it. There's no safe place for it. Because in the first one, I felt like she was resisting descending. I have a female dog in heat right now also, and when she was in her most fertile period, she just blossomed in a way, and she was so vulnerable to my male dogs. Nothing happened, but I really got to see on a real primitive, primal level that energy of how when she was at her peak of her femininity, how the males were just like nuts. They weren't even in their minds anymore, and it just brought the danger of it to me, and just bringing it up.
This was taken from the diaries of writing of a transsexual who had, I believe, like the first operation.
I had this image of the shamans in Mongolia or China or Siberia, really, how they were men, but they dressed as women to have this healing quality in the, I'm not sure if the word's tribe, but the group. And I got this image of men were jealous of women, that they have this connection to the earth and power, and that they have the, I'm not sure if the word's jealous, but maybe, I don't know.
Well, they did that because they needed to have that connection to the feminine to do their work.
So
they had a marriage, they had a sacred marriage to the feminine.
So that's the kind of image that is a seeking union, but like physically looking like a woman. It was kind of disturbing to me, though. I mean,
yeah, sure.
But beautiful, too.
Yeah.
So how did we go from that to where we are now?
How did we get there with the patriarchy and whatever? The civilizations. Yeah, that's sad, isn't it?
Fear.
A different logos, a different way of imagining the world. But I think what Jung is saying, what Jung is saying is that this is the piece that's missing, that we need to bring it back in order to find wholeness, in order to heal the world. I mean, there are lots of pieces missing, but this is a major piece that's missing.
Could you talk a little bit more about that?
Well, I don't want to get too far away from this at the moment, Jan.
Just the comment about the dogs made me think of if a female dog is in heat and the male dogs are kind of out of their mind, and I know I'm not trying to compare animals to humans, but you know, where does the patriarchy doesn't come into play in that behavior? How do we resolve that? There's part of it is instinctual.
Absolutely.
Even in us as human animals. How do we resolve that?
Well,
does patriarchy come in?
We don't have these rituals. We don't have these places. So it just sort of runs rampant, doesn't it?
Yeah.
We don't have places where we come to an understanding in ourselves of what that energy is. It's nowhere. Just like the rituals for the boys to become men or the women to become, the girls to become women. So, you know, this would be part of that. So
What did you see? Go ahead.
Which is the corollary. I keep saying corollaries today, but I think about the Dionysus that you mentioned. The Maenads went out of their minds. That's
mm-hmm.
when the women go around out of their minds.
With dance.
With dance. And I think about the Beatles and how the women were reacted to that.
Mm-hmm.
So both sides go out of their
mm-hmm.
minds
mm-hmm.
to a polarity.
Yeah.
And how does how can that be inform us?
How can that inform us? That's very important. How do we become conscious of it, and how can it then be integrated and inform us?
Yeah, and how can we not just split it off?
Not just split it off. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I love this last piece because it's the prostitute becomes the sacred prostitute.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. She
mm-hmm.
sees it and she
yeah.
guides
yeah.
him.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
They're dancing together. It's
yeah.
a beautiful
yeah.
connection.
Yeah.
Yeah, and on that line, it almost feels, it made me feel kind of, the more I thought about it, reflecting on this, it's like a little bit sad because there's that glass there,
mm-hmm.
you know, so there's a clear
mm-hmm.
reason, you know, it wasn't necessarily, you know, to support that,
mm-hmm.
in, you know, because I was almost, I don't remember the movie, it's like the detail of the movie, because it's been a bit since I've seen it, like whether she closes that curtain or she just leaves, but it's, versus like, I'm wondering, like the harlot, the sacred prostitute, more of a connection.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, it kind of felt a little bit like how useful that would have been for him,
mm-hmm.
or they, you know,
mm-hmm.
In that moment. It kind of also is symbolic of what's not okay
mm-hmm.
in our culture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Laura.
She put her robe on just at the exact the perfect moment when she knew he had received what he needed, and it was the ritual was done. The ritual was okay, and like the Annunciation. Yeah. Any other feelings that come up about this? It's such a powerful moment.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
I have. Does it, I haven't seen the movie, but does it go into the issue of, now you said that this was the beginning for the first operation where it becomes a woman?
Yeah, he dies, unfortunately. It doesn't, it's not successful.
Oh, it wasn't successful.
Well,
oh,
first
well,
operation.
They wouldn't do
they
that.
Didn't know
yeah.
what to do.
Yeah. Well, I guess the question would have been is if you were a lifelong man who had basically the habits of being a man,
mm-hmm.
What would the issues then be of going from one that viewpoint, a
mm-hmm.
cultural viewpoint, if anything, into the viewpoint of being a woman?
Weird, isn't it? But, yeah, I mean, I think that's what the movie's trying to portray. Like his wife, you know, start. I mean, he had this. He knew Lily before. He knew his feminine before, but he repressed it. And then his wife brings it out.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, it's all about their relationship and what he does. And it's beautiful. It's a beautiful, loving relationship. So, so you can go see the movie.
Yeah.
I really teared up in that first, the first segment.
Mm.
I mean, Eddie Redmayne's, I haven't seen the film, so I'm going to see if Eddie Redmayne's performance is so poignant there.
Mm-hmm.
Every moment in his eyes, the shift,
mm-hmm.
you see
yeah.
his soul.
Incredible.
Yeah.
You really
yeah.
see his soul, like he's struggling, and I felt it very touching
mm-hmm.
to be witness, like I was instead of witnessing a sacred moment.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
amazing.
Just so simple,
mm-hmm. yeah.
so deep. That's what we're looking for, this simple, deep.
And the thing that is interesting to me, too, it's art that shows us this.
Uh-huh.
And, like, we need ritual.
Mm-hmm.
We need something to hold it, because I'm not sure it was quite so luscious in
yeah,
his experience
of it,
right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it was something. But I think because we're always reflecting,
mm-hmm.
each other, it's very hard to allow the space to allow another person that intimacy with their own self.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that art allows us mm-hmm. to view that, and ritual allows us to view that. And this, you know, the conversation we're having here,
mm-hmm.
because we're all sort of becoming one one vessel.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I think in life, it's really hard to...
yeah, it's really about intimacy, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Intimacy, yeah.
I was struck with, we've been talking about heaven and hell being, both needing to be held in one, and that these clips really portray both the exhilaration in him and the anguish in him. And for one to remember that comes in a breaking open and a blossoming.
Yeah, it's a very vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
We have to be vulnerable
mm-hmm.
in order to transform. It's really hard.
Mm-hmm. It was the element of that it brought me was trust, learning to explore trust of himself
yeah.
and trust of other in that intimacy.
Yeah, yeah. Trust of self and others. Yeah. Particularly of self.
I would just appreciate the universal excavation of the self that is happening that I always can relate to, and the fact that so much is done in silence.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Even through this film, there's not much dialogue
mm-hmm.
on Dave's part. So much is done internally,
mm-hmm.
and that's something that I think with the sensual and sexual
mm-hmm.
aspect of
right.
ourselves.
It's not about words, is it?
Mm-hmm.
It's not about I need to know this and I need to know what that is and I need to make this and da da da. It's about what emerges in the nonverbal.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So. Artistic creation lies so incredibly close to sex, its pain and its ecstasy, that the two manifestations are indeed different forms of one and the same yearning.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Talk about it. Incredibly beautiful man. So, moving a little forward into now, who are our sexual icons now? I read, if anybody knows this book on Cleopatra, it's the latest biography, if you can call it a biography, because we don't know anything about Cleopatra.
Who wrote that one?
It's Stacy Schiff. She's
yes.
a historian. And she puts together this amazing portrayal of Cleopatra through mostly anecdotal, historic, political writings. It's just phenomenal. The only image we have of her is on her on the coin that she minted. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
We have lots of images of her, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
we have lots of ideas of her. And
do you recommend the book?
It's very dense, very dense. She describes exactly what everybody was wearing. I mean, it's phenomenal. But if you want to learn about Cleopatra, this is it. Actually, this is going to be made into a movie, everybody. Guess who's going to be Cleopatra? Angelina Jolie.
That's
what I hear. One of our sexual icons, I guess?
Yeah.
Interesting. But she was the richest, the most powerful at times, the most powerful person in the Mediterranean. She was a goddess in Egypt. She was spoke 9 languages. She was incredibly sensual and knew, she was an incredible politician.
She was smart.
She was
really smart.
She was a strategist.
Politically smart.
She was articulate. She She made mistakes in the end, as we all know. But she was a benign dictator.
Mm-hmm.
Egypt was definitely a dictatorship, but she really took care of her people.
Mm-hmm.
She fed them when there was famine. She listened to their pleas. She was a phenomenal woman. And one of the ways she ruled back then, I mean, in Egypt, men and women were equal. So she didn't have any problem with that. But in Rome, which is what she was connecting with, men and women weren't equal. Women didn't even have personhood. So she was trying to connect with this very, and she was, well, she had one son with Caesar, I think two with Anthony,
mm-hmm.
I think. And somebody, I think that was, have you read this?
No, I read a different one.
Yeah. And one of the things she knew really how to do is to put on this amazing, sensational, beautiful pageantry,
mm-hmm.
and sensuality and parades. And she knew how to set the stage.
Mm-hmm.
And she knew how to seduce.
Mm-hmm.
What did you do back then? I mean, she was incredibly empowered. And this woman says she was no more Egyptian than Elizabeth Taylor. She came from the Ptolemies, who were from Greece, from
mm-hmm.
Macedonia,
mm-hmm.
and they finally took over Egypt, and they were conniving,
mm-hmm.
power-hungry,
mm-hmm.
greedy,
mm-hmm.
Destructive family. Everybody, they killed each other.
Mm-hmm.
That's how they got power.
All families did then.
Well, that's true. All families did. It's not a historical record.
I mean, it you know, that's how power, that's why you had to be careful of your own family,
yeah.
right?
And that more careful of your family than other people.
Because they were always killing each other.
Right.
In fact, that's how the book begins, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Her brother's thrown her out into the desert.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering about, when we're talking about this whole oneness of the goddess, that it's something other, that right now we split the atom, we split everything for power.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, there is some sort of power in the splitting.
Mm-hmm.
But that we're talking about this other kind of power of fusion,
mm-hmm.
right.
and that's a power.
Yeah.
And that's a power we're so full of the splitting power.
Mm-hmm.
And how do we get to that other power?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Do we have any really healthy feminine icons? Are they healthy? I mean, poor women, my God. What do they have to be to be a female icon in this culture?
It's sad, but that's the female icon for young girls.
Michelle Obama?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
She's a pretty amazing woman, isn't she?
Do we really have that many masculine inside of them?
True, but we're talking about the feminine now, so we're do we have any masculine men who portray the feminine? You know?
Hmm. That's what's confusing to me, that both men and women have masculine and feminine
mm-hmm.
In them.
Mm-hmm.
And women are allowed to portray the feminine and a little bit of the masculine, but men aren't really allowed to portray the feminine.
Mm-hmm.
They're not allowed to go like this.
Mm-hmm.
No, that's not considered attractive.
And
it's
if you're gay.
Right. If you're gay. So there's a split there.
Mm-hmm.
And it's frustrating and confusing, and limiting,
and
it makes me mad too.
Mm-hmm.
I feel it's not fair.
Yeah, we've all been split off from our own sense of that, right? And so we don't know what to do. I think to me, the healing comes when any of us can own that aspect. And go, you know, you don't have to flaunt it, you don't have to display it and exhibit it, but if you can just own it and feel okay with that, bring it into your life. What would bringing it into your life mean? In simple ways. We don't have to have mystical experiences to bring the feminine energy into our lives.
Well, to be gay is to be happy, which is kind of ironic.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
thought the.
Most cultures that are, we have most modern cultures, right? I mean, India has a very sensual, beautiful, rhythmic life. And, but when you get into gender, you know, it's not there. I have friends from Sri Lanka, and he's Sri Lankan, she's American, and he was visiting, and he just moves his head like this all the time. Wow, that's really, wow, I wish I, my neck was that relaxed. I could just move my head like this. But it was a lovely, you know, he had these, this sort of feminine gestures that, that were very sweet and relaxing. So.
You know, I think there's a big difference between talking about mainstream American culture and looking below the surface, like even in Western Mass. Mm-hmm. There's pagan groups, there's pan-fidelity groups, there's all kinds of sensual dance groups that I'm aware of.
Mm-hmm.
At Smith College, there are explorations among women in, you know, all different varieties. I don't know exactly what they are, but so there's, you know, I think it's you know, it's important to look, to distinguish and not just look at one or the other, but realize the multiplicity.
Yeah, so there are places in our culture where these, this can be worked with, or not just going to bed or having sex.
Oh, I was just thinking about the different types of power, and I keep going back to how dangerous it is to be in that zone, and, well, especially if you're a man, and that it's a threat to a certain type of power, the power over, so that if a man doesn't appear like what a man's supposed to, it threatens all manhood's power, the patriarchal power. Whereas the power of the feminine, erotic, is a power that comes from a different place. If you're not in that zone, you don't understand it. You want to own that.
So, threatened by it. Yeah.
And that is, so, is related to a lot of thoughts I've been having about the sacred prostitute. And the idea of, when we think of prostitute, we think of a man going to a prostitute to have dominance over her, to express domination. But in that scenario of this idea of, in the past, of the sacred prostitute, you go to experience the goddess. So you actually go to submit and become one with the divine through that act, not to oppress someone. Even though you're the man, the penetrating force.
Even though that's really important, even though you're the penetrating force, it's not about being the penetrating force, it's about surrendering to the penetrating force. Okay? It's about opening to the, and also then receiving the feminine.
So to kind of answer your question a little bit of the role models for the feminine, I think it's the those that are able to embrace or really embody the inverse of that. So like women who are able to really embody the masculine, some seem like sports players, like, you know, Venus Williams or soccer players and stuff. And for men, it would be like musicians. So it's being able to express like the more almost feminine things in a way that like our society almost can accept or hold and still be able to embrace and move in those ways.
You know, I think one of the places Hillary couldn't reach us is that she sort of she repressed her feminine, you know, so we couldn't feel her. Where Michelle Obama, when she gives a speech, she's just coming from the heart, right? She's intelligent, she's thoughtful, but she also comes from the heart. You can see, you can feel her.
I'm wondering how all this about feminine, the feminine erotic,
relates or doesn't relate to the and what somebody mentioned before, the anima and animus.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I'm just not sure how
yeah.
how these if there's any is are they completely separate? Or I mean they're probably not.
Well, the animus would be the woman's classically, the woman's masculine
right.
connection. Masculine. And the anima would be the man, because he's already man. His feminine.
Right.
So yeah, the feminine, but the woman, see, Jung grew up in a time in Switzerland, of course, that was very provincial, and 1875, he was born. So he was in a very patriarchal culture, very repressed patriarchal culture. And he was searching for this, but when he developed the whole anima-animus thing, he was looking at his culture. He was looking at the women. Well, in the U.S. too, women were coming to him. And he was looking at them and trying to help them connect with their soul, and also realizing how caught they were in their cultural roles. And so that's how he developed this man and woman and the man. So, but he was looking at their cultural roles too, and how that affected their ability to.
But he also said that the anima, is that how you pronounce it, or animus, is the guide, the
mm-hmm.
mediator
mm-hmm.
between the consciousness and the unconsciousness. And I think that's really interesting.
For the man.
For the man, or for the woman, it's the animus.
Mm-hmm. And his classical, interestingly enough, the biggest self, the archetype of archetypes, the wholeness, for the woman is feminine, and for the man is masculine.
Mm-hmm.
So we're guided by the opposite, but we get to, you know, but that's getting a little technical, a little conceptual.
Okay.
Right? This whole masculine and feminine is fascinating, isn't it? How do we talk about it without getting into gender?
It is interesting, too, because I feel like there's a certain, I feel like what we're trying to get to with fusion or something is the ability to experience. And it's interesting, too, because it's almost like, you know, we're the ability to experience the witness again, or that oneness, which isn't masculine or feminine per se, but plays with masculine and feminine, or plays with the world at large. And in parts of shamanism too, you're shape-shifting and time-shifting, and I mean, I think there are those of us who touch the freedom of that,
mm.
and there are a lot of people who are really scared of the freedom of that,
mm-hmm.
and I think that's what our age is struggling with
mm-hmm.
right now,
mm-hmm.
is that, you know, a lot of us are quite willing to explore and would like to encourage other people's explorations and however they talk about it, really, but there are a lot of people who haven't touched that at all, or are sort of like this young man who really are at a loss of what to do with it. I mean, maybe he knew perfectly what to do with it, but is, you know, so, I mean, it's a very, but I think partially it's not about the male and female. I think that's how Jung experienced it, perhaps. But I think it's about the emptiness and the manifestation,
mm.
and
right. And but what I think what we're trying to talk about here is that I feel like we've lost our all of us the feminine road, the feminine stream energy to connect with that oneness.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Well, we've lost that oneness.
Well, but we can't get to the oneness until we connect with this, with masculine energy, but also this feminine.
Well, maybe not.
Yeah.
Maybe you get to the oneness first, and then you play with the masculine and the
yeah.
feminine. I mean, different people, right?
Yeah.
Your question about how to bring this into our lives seems very important as we're ending now. And, you know, one piece I was contemplating has to do with allowing myself to be penetrated by
life.
Mm-hmm.
Like in the little moments, like mundane little moments,
mm-hmm.
out cross-country skiing, or in the calendar,
mm-hmm.
or a moment in a film, or in the grocery store. Like, how far am I willing to be touched?
Yeah.
And
uh-huh.
that feels like one way that I can invite the goddess. And a man I went out with recently said to me, "You're so feminine, the way you move." And I looked at him and I said, "Hard won."
Mm-hmm.
And I really thought, you know, I'm 60 now, as you know, and I really thought about my own mother, clueless,
mm-hmm.
unbelievably wounded in that area, and how we all can do this. We can all take this up in
mm-hmm.
our daily lives in some way. It doesn't have to be a big, you know, weekend workshop on the goddess.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it can really be moment by moment. That's what I'm
yeah.
sensing personally.
Yeah, it's not really out there. We can get pointers, but we have to find it in here.
Yeah, it's not the finger pointing at the moon.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I just have increasing respect for what it takes to open to frequency. It's like such a different frequency.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved in alchemy, coagulate the spirit. Because to prepare the body at all the chakras to actually have open to that fluid receptivity, I find it's gradual,
mm-hmm.
with, you know, precious leaps
mm-hmm.
on occasion that feel, you know. And I remember when I was in my 40s, hearing Nelson Mandela via Marianne Williamson's quote about what we're afraid of is our power.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, I'm not afraid of my power. You know, I was so in my animus, you know. And it was like, you know, gradually, that just keeps coming back to me of like that, you know, it's the power of the self, and you can't have it. You just can't have it. You can only be it. And that's such a different frequency. It's like you have to prepare the outlets or the inlets.
When I was in Houston, I worked with a lot of people in corporations, a lot of women in corporations, and, you know, middle, sort of upper middle management. And it was really profound to work with them, being in these very patriarchal corporations,
mm-hmm.
and for them to try to connect with their feminine. A lot of their dreams, of course, brought up this stuff. And there was a woman, French, really lovely woman, and she wore these 3-inch heels. I don't know how she did that. And she was determined to not give up her feminine power. She really dressed as a woman. And she had an active imagination once where she was got really into herself, and she experienced herself as a Tyrannosaurus Rex with a big tail that kind of grounded her.
Mm-hmm.
And then another of her icons was Carmen Bizet. She had a beautiful voice, so she sang. And so to try to bring this Carmen energy and then this Tyrannosaurus Rex energy together will take her lifetime.
Yeah.
Right? And then I have another client, I'll sort of end with this, who I've worked with for a very long time. I still work with her in Houston. Some came from a very traumatic background, amazing, really came through. She said the first 20 years were the hardest of analysis. First 20 years were the hardest. And early on in her work, she had this amazing dream that we actually talked about this week, that she reminded me of. And she's in a garden, the feminine, the goddess. And there's a penis. And she picks up the penis. It's about a foot long, somewhat large penis. And she looks inside of it. And she sees a beautiful, colorful kaleidoscope turning. In constantly changing in the penis. And that was the dream.
Mm-hmm.
And we've been working on that for years and years and years and years,
mm-hmm.
of her relationship to the garden in her, and then this masculine energy, which isn't thrusting, it has the self inside.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she's looking in it.
she's gazing in it. Isn't that a beautiful image? Mm-hmm. She's still working on it. It's like, what does that mean? Mm-hmm. And then recently she had a dream where she, in her sand trays, Marilyn Monroe came up, and then also Madonna. Mm-hmm. So Marilyn Monroe has this gold dress on. She's being Marilyn Monroe. And Madonna is very strong, and you know. And so these, she continues to work with these two female energies in her, very sexual, but very different. And she struggles with that and how to hold her own feminine power in her work. She doesn't want to give that up. So she had this dream about a year ago. She's in a long cathedral, and she and three women are on the left. No, she three women and her, three women are on the right, and she's on the left. And there's a priest with a big mitre hat, kind of like a bishop's hat or something, doing the service. And the women start chanting, "We're too tired. We're too tired. We're too tired. We're too tired to help you with your plan. We're too tired to help you with your plan." And that was the dream, and it was a real breakthrough for her to go, "No, I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm going to sing. I'm going to chant." And one of the things she's discovered in her, she's always painted her images a lot, and she does a lot of watercolor now. It's a place where she really finds the creative, wonderful, flowing energy for herself. So I think it's so important that we find this energy. We bring it to the world. You know? So any last thoughts or? Sexuality is the strongest symbol at the disposal of the psyche. That's a pretty big declaration. I love this. The procreative power no longer proceeds from God. Rather, God is born from the soul. So, what? Yes, Carol.
Yeah, I wanted to thank you for doing this presentation.
Wow.
Yeah. Gives me an opportunity to share one thing, which I don't share because I just don't feel like upsetting people. But when I saw you do the early goddesses and the progression from showing the vulva to having a less of a presentation, finally covering it. And it wasn't, I think it was about 15 years ago, some women and I got together and I did a show on the erotic, sacred feminine. And one of the things I felt compelled to do was, and I don't mean this to be so personal, but I think it's about insisting, I keep trying to insist, and I hope other men and women will too, on being the erotic feminine soul. But I just had to take pictures of my vulva, and I had about 15 of them, mm-hmm. and I put them up on the wall, and then somebody I know who's in the audience also did a few sculptures, which I put up, and then we had four other women, you know, do different things, and it was so fantastic, and I had a thing at the beginning with a magnifying glass, and it said, "Look." My theme of the show was look until you see something you love. Mm-hmm. And people had to read before they came in the room. They had to come through a pink veil. Mm-hmm. And they had to read it. And if they understood it was sacred, they were invited in. Mm-hmm. And the people who came in, men and women, were just so open and so receptive. But it just took the courage of the five of us to do that show. So I just want to mention, and then I never speak about it, but it was a fantastic experience.
How long ago was this?
It was about, it was about 15 years ago. I was in my late 50s, And the energy in there was so fantastic that I was moved to do an extemporaneous dance and poetic thing to people about being a goddess and coming upon a man in the garden who understood the goddess. Mm-hmm. And when I finished, mm-hmm. the women who, I didn't know the audience, they just came. The audience, the women were crying, and the men were standing there, their eyes were just glowing with love. It was quite an experience.
There you go.
So thanks for giving me the chance to share it, but to see what's going on, and that's all I know.
This is a lovely book. This is, when was this published? Last year?
A couple years ago.
Is that...
Sherry Winston.
Yes.
Winston.
Yeah, I just, she's a friend of mine. Yeah,
so there are places, that's the question. How do we find places where we can put this energy, where we can play with it and explore it? Okay, thank you for coming and join us at the Mosaic for a little